Good morning and welcome to the 21st meeting of 2023 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. This morning we have received no apologies. Our first agenda item is to agree to take item 3, which is consideration of today's evidence in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. Our second agenda item is to take evidence on the reconsideration stage of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, Incorporation Scotland Bill. We will be taking evidence from two panels this morning, and I welcome our first panel, which is Nicola Keehan from Children and Young People's Commissioner, Scotland. Gina Wilson, who is the Head of Strategy, also from the Children and Young People's Commissioner, Scotland. Juliet Harris, Director of Together, Scottish Alliance for Children's Rights. Jan Savage, who is the Executive Director of the Scottish Human Rights Commission. And Fiona Mingus, who is the Policy Manager at the Law Society of Scotland. Welcome to you all. I refer members to Papers 1 and 2, but before we begin with our questioning, I would like to invite each of the witnesses to make some brief opening remarks, should they wish to do so. I'll start with Nicola, please.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you for the opportunity to come and speak with you all today and give evidence. I took office as the Children and Young People's Commissioner in August. During my interview for the role by Children and Young People, I was asked to outline my top priority. It wasn't a difficult choice for me to make. Ensuring that the UNCRC was incorporated into Scots law was my first priority. And this was and is because of the following reasons. Children and young people in Scotland have been campaigning for this for years, and they still are. It will accelerate the culture change that has started to ensure children's rights are centred by decision makers. It will give children and young people additional powers to hold decision makers to account. I know children and young people may be watching us today, so I want to be clear. I support the approach that Scottish Government has proposed to take to amend the bill. This legislation, if passed, will provide greater protections for children's rights now, and it will create the foundations on which we can build on those protections into the future. This will be a long-term investment focused on the future and beyond parliamentary cycles, not just an immediate return. And if the bill is subject to further referral on scope, I am concerned the opportunity will be lost. This is an amended bill. However, the intention of the Scottish Parliament to weave the UNCRC into the fabric of our law, our policy and our public life in Scotland is still achievable. The then Minister for Children and Young People, Marie Todd, opening the Stage 3 debate on the UNCRC bill in March 2021, said, "I want this legislation to help deliver a huge cultural shift, but let us not forget the small changes that will also make a difference to children's everyday lives and which can send clear and unequivocal messages about what a child-centred society truly looks like. Raising awareness and understanding of children's rights will create a lasting legacy. It will mean that the children of today grow up to empower the children of tomorrow. We should make no mistake, this matters to Scotland's children." My office agreed with the Minister then, and I agree with her now. You have received evidence from others explaining that the amended bill makes things more complicated. It does, for now. But there is a path that Scottish Government can create to help duty bearers and children and young people to understand what changes can happen now and how they can continue to adapt future legislation to bring more and more areas into scope. As the convener mentioned, I'm joined today by my colleague Gina Wilson, Head of Strategy for my office, and we look forward to providing any information we can to support the committee's scrutiny of the amended bill. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicola, and welcome to your role. Congratulations on your appointment. I believe this is your first appearance. Welcome. Gina, do you wish to add? No, thank you. Jan.
Good morning. Thank you, convener. So the Scottish Human Rights Commission welcomes the commencement of the reconsideration stage of the UNCRC incorporation bill. Children, young people and their families have waited a very long time for this. Incorporation of children's rights is essential for children and young people to secure accountability with the, when the rights that they already do have under the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child are not adequately considered by public bodies here in Scotland. This is also the view of the United Nations Committee on the Rights of the Child. So is this where we thought we would be when this process started? No. Is this more complex than we envisaged at the start of this process? Yes. Is that a reason not to proceed? Absolutely not. Is this the best way to go forward with the bill? Yes. It's a messy and it's a complex route, but it's the only route forward. Our view is that this is the only way to proceed and we do not have an alternative to propose to you. We've reviewed through the lens of A, minimising the risk of referral back to the Supreme Court, B, to reduce complexity and to provide clarity for duty bearers and for children and young people alike, and C, to maximise the coverage within devolved competence, and we have not identified an alternative. Today, and as you move through the evidence sessions, you will hear concerns about complexity and burden on duty bearers. It is complex. But firstly, the starting point is already complex. We don't have a straightforward system, really, in terms of access to justice for human rights in Scotland. Secondly, and this is a really fundamental point that you as a committee and the Parliament are faced with, progressing for now with improving children and young people's lives through stronger application of their human rights in the Scottish legal framework, do you give up because it's difficult? More difficult than envisaged? Or do you progress? Do you start on a new path and a new journey and open the door for a new human rights framework for children and young people in Scotland? That's not really a choice. That must be done, and therefore this Commission supports the proposals from the Scottish Government.
Thank you. Thanks, Jan. Juliet?
Thank you, and thank you for inviting me here today. To prepare, I have spoken widely to children and young people, and all of them have pointed out today is Halloween. So, two of our rights detectives, Oscar and Sophia, have helped me to prepare an opening statement with a Halloween theme that sets out what children and young people think about the amendments to the bill. So, starting, here is a Halloween web. This is a strong web that represents protections for children's rights. And here are some flies. And as they buzz around, they represent breaches of children's rights, and they're caught by the web. And here is Shirley Ann Spider, the Cabinet Secretary. She's in charge of the web, along with our Spider MSPs and our Spider Courts. And this web here represents the UNCRC bill as it was passed in March 2021. You can see it provides protections against breaches of children's rights across all areas devolved to Scotland. It was really tough for any of these flies to get through. But the UK Supreme Court means that the web has had to change. It's now a looser web, where children's rights might not always be so well protected. Whilst it catches some flies, other flies might sneak through. But even though this web isn't so neat, children and young people say this is critical. The very fact that a web exists actually scares away the flies, much like the UNCRC bill will help to prevent breaches of children's rights through its very existence. With no web, flies might fly everywhere. They might think they can do as they please. Children and young people really worry that without any UNCRC bill, adults might think they don't need to worry about children's rights. So this web, it's not perfect, but it's still absolutely an essential framework to protect children's rights. And in years to come, the Cabinet Secretary, the Scottish Government, the courts and other MSPs can strengthen this web. They have the power to improve it. All the spiders can identify where there might be weaknesses, and they can actually get to work to fix them and improve the web in future years. So in years to come, as I say, government, courts, the Parliament, you all have the power to improve this web. All the spiders can identify the weaknesses and where the flies get through. So while the bill that we're looking at now isn't perfect, children are very clear that it's really important that it becomes law. It will provide the essential framework that we need in Scotland to promote a rights-respecting culture. And over time, this web can grow into this web, and so that we have the strongest possible protections for children's rights in Scotland.
Thank you, Juliet. I'm always impressed by the clarity of children's thoughts and how they can bring that alive through visual aids and storytelling. So thank you very much for that. Fiona.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, everyone. Thank you for inviting the Law Society to join this panel this morning. The Law Society has a statutory duty to work in the public interest, part of this work being our strong commitment to protecting and promoting the rule of law and seeking to influence the making of a fairer and more just society through creation of good law, law which is clear, accessible and effective. We're pleased to see UNCRC incorporation being reconsidered, and you'll know that we were and remain supportive of what the bill intends to achieve. You'll see our comments on the amendments in our written submission, and all I'd intend to add in these brief opening comments is a word on the wider societal context in which we consider these, highlighting again the importance of duty bearers having the necessary resources, education and capacity to meaningfully comply so that rights of children aren't lost in that compliance. We would also add that it will be important to balance the legal context with the everyday practicalities for end users, both duty bearers and children and young people. I look forward to a wider discussion on these important issues this morning. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you to all our panellists. Just to get us started, I wondered if any of the panellists would like to share their view of the Scottish Government's approach in responding to the Supreme Court judgment and its proposed amendments in the UNCRC bill. I did notice, Jan, that in your opening statement you felt that this was the only way to sort of proceed and there were no alternatives. So perhaps you'd like to give me a bit of insight into why you've so firmly believe that and whether any other alternatives were considered at all. So if I could come to Jan first, and if there are any other panellists that can indicate to me that they would like to come in.
I'm happy to give that a go. Certainly our analysis has been informed by consultation with our colleagues at the Children's Commissioner's Office, who have really taken the lead in the interests of avoiding duplication of effort across both bodies, and have done some sterling work in pulling together an expert group and ensuring that the appropriate analysis was given into the Scottish Government. And it is our judgment that in the interests of a lack of complexity, reducing that risk of referral back to the Supreme Court, and actually establishing a framework from where the Scottish Government and successive Scottish Governments indeed and the Scottish Parliament from here can seek to close that web, as Juliet so eloquently and simply managed to explain to us there, that this is the best if only option available at this point in time to the Scottish Government. It's not where the journey started, and it's not an ideal piece of legislation, but this route as amended is the only route that we can see to enable those steps to be taken, and we do not have an alternative to propose.
Okay. Did you have any involvement in the preparation or the development of the amendments at all?
More formally, we left that with our colleagues in the Children's Commissioner's Office, as you would expect. They did keep us fully appraised of those discussions, and we absolutely were able to confirm their analysis as informing ours.
Okay. Nicola,
Yep, so as you'll have heard in my opening statement, we also are very supportive of the Scottish Government's response and the amendments in the bill as proposed now. I think for us it's really important that we reiterate the focus on what is still within that bill. You know, so it will give children and young people additional protection and powers. That is really important for us. It will also introduce the Children's Rights Scheme. It will introduce the requirements for children's rights impact assessments to be undertaken where there are strategic decisions being made by duty bearers, and child-friendly complaints mechanisms. Again, just to reinforce that, the team over the past month has consulted with partners, with experts and with children and young people to look at the amendments and assess whether we felt as if there were alternative approaches. But we did continuously come back to the decision that we felt as if this gives the strongest opportunity for the UNCRC bill to be incorporated into Scots law. And there is a path to broaden the scope of that over time. In terms of contribution to the amendments, I'll just bring Gina in there as we that became a much later date.
Thank you. In terms of the work that we did directly with government around the development of the amendments, we didn't work with government to produce the amendments. We didn't see any of their legal advice in advance of the production of them, but they did share with us after a period of time that the tests they were looking at were about how to minimise the risk of referral, how to maximise coverage, and how to ensure the legislation was accessible. And we did support the approach that they were taking in order to try and examine the options that were available to them in terms of amendments. We did take a view immediately after the Supreme Court judgment that the form of the amendments you have now was the likely route, that this was where we thought we would end up. And we thought this was probably the version which was going to be acceptable to UK government in terms of what didn't seem to breach on scope again. So we have ended up where I think we predicted we were going to be.
OK, thank you. Any of the other panellists like to come in? Juliet, thank you.
Yeah, I think it's really important to stress that incorporation is a journey and we're still on that journey. And whilst the amendments do mean we're further back on that journey, we still need to continue forward. Incorporation, no matter the scale, no matter the method, is always going to be worthwhile. It's always going to be that beneficial first step that helps to create the framework that Nicola spoke about. I think it's important to note that earlier this year, the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child specifically made a recommendation for the Scottish Government to bring these amendments expeditiously back to the Scottish Parliament to make sure that we can continue on that journey towards incorporation. And I think as the work that we have done with our members, with legal experts, with children and young people shows how this is a framework that we can build on. We've shared with you a letter to the Cabinet Secretary where we set out four specific asks, which I'll go into later on in my evidence, as to how actually we can build in the future with ministerial commitments on this initial framework for children's rights. In terms of our involvement, then we have been involved with Scottish Government. As Gina says, we haven't seen the legal workings from Scottish Government on the amendments, but they have kept us up to date, they have kept us informed, and they have involved our membership. Back in June 2022, we had a targeted engagement from Scottish Government at that point through the Strategic Implementation Board. And at this point, they let us know that they were seeking as much coverage as possible from the compatibility duty. They were seeking to minimise the referral to the Supreme Court, and they wanted the duty to be accessible as possible. And at that point, our members were really supportive of that approach. There's been a further engagement in detail in June of this year, and this was with the Children's Commissioner's Office, SHRC and UNICEF. At that point, then, Scottish Government did set out some options for us. And whilst we were unable as a membership organisation to specifically state our support for any one of those options, it would have meant consulting with 550 different people, different organisations. We were very clear that we welcomed Scottish Government's approach. I think it's so important to our membership that we don't see another UK Supreme Court referral. We just want to move forward on this journey. So whilst there might be criticism that Scottish Government has been a little bit cautious, perhaps, in its approach to amendment, perhaps they could have gone further, our membership is very content that we minimise that the risk of another referral, and we take forward other commitments that we can strengthen the web, as children and young people have told me, to make sure that we build on these protections in the future.
Thank you for that. I'm going to bring in my colleague Paul, who will be followed by Megan.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel, and thank you for the helpful overview. I'm going to ask questions about the legal complexities, and I suppose some of the views that have been shared by other organisations we'll hear from this morning as well. So COSLA and Social Work Scotland have both indicated that the legal complexities that will be created following the amendments will be challenging. Indeed, Social Work Scotland told us they viewed it as a potentially impossible legislative landscape to navigate. So, I mean, I think what we've heard quite clearly from all of you in evidence so far is that this is the only option. I suppose the question would be, what do you think the impact on duty bearers under the bill will be, and how can we perhaps help them to navigate and address those complexities?
I wonder if Fiona, would this be a good one for you to come in, and then I can bring in other members?
Yes, so in terms specifically on duty bearers and the impact on them, obviously duty bearers here will be better placed to answer specifically how they feel about that. We would say that we obviously need to consider and be conscious of the capacity of duty bearers, which others have highlighted in their written submissions, as you say, and of course there are some legal complexities. In terms of that, there's obviously many strands to that. If the bill becomes law, advisers will need to take into account children's rights under the new Act, relevant provisions in Acts of the Scottish Parliament, and assess compatibility and relevant provisions in Acts of the UK Parliament, their impact and effect. Perhaps the Scottish Government might look to provide some detailed guidance taking into account each article of the UNCRC in identifying the relevant Scottish and UK legislation to aid duty bearers in their work. You'll be aware that complexities and gaps have been highlighted that could potentially be created. So things in terms of having to ascertain compatibility and the large mix of legislation in place here used by duty bearers, so covering children's rights, a mix of acts of the Scottish Parliament and also of the UK Parliament. So there's potential for a layer of complexity there and potential gaps where some of the legislation would fall outside the scope. So from purely legal standpoint, I think that kind of highlights the potential gaps and complexities that others have spoken about. But I think duty bearers have to then find a balance there with how and to what extent these are likely to play out practically, and having regard to that practical information implementation for duty bearers. And I think others will be better placed to talk to that.
Nicola, please.
Can you hear me okay? Yep. So I think our clear message is that duty bearers should be focusing on acting compatibly across all elements of the UNCRC. You know, 2 years ago, that's what Scotland was preparing for, and we would urge everybody to continue to deliver on that and focus on that. We do also believe that there are some really clear commitments that Scottish Government can make to be able to support duty bearers. So in terms of the legislative review and audit, really clear communications that are, you know, to support everyone, including children and young people. But ultimately, we do feel as if this gives additional powers, but wherever there are additional powers, it's about choices and using those in circumstances as a last resort. So we would always be looking to ensure that children's rights are fulfilled at the local level, wherever possible. We should always be looking to see across all elements that children have opportunities with trusted adults at a local level to be able to identify that and support them. So our message is that all duty bearers should be looking to act compatibly all of the time across all elements of the bill, and Scottish Government can support by giving some clear guidance, some clear commitments and some clear communications about how this, what changes now from a legislative point of view and what can continue to change into the future.
Thank you. Juliet?
Thank you, and completely support what Nicola has said and the importance of actually focusing on the carrot rather than the stick. It's really important to note that the reduction in scope of the bill is only in relation to legal enforcement. So all the other factors that are included in the bill, it's a holistic bill that has actually been designed right from the outset to prevent breaches of children's rights. So there's a whole section of the bill that we're not looking at in reconsideration that's there in place to stop breaches, to prevent breaches. So the fly is being scared of keeping away from the web. And so it's really important to note that that's in place and that the reduction in scope only does apply if children's rights are breached and they need to use the UNCRC to seek remedy and redress. And like I've mentioned before, then there are all sorts of models of incorporation internationally. In these models internationally, they don't always cover all the different parts of the UNCRC. It can be piecemeal, it can be across the board. And we've spoken to UNICEF, and they have said that there's no evidence that they've seen that those that have taken a partial or unique approach are actually seeing issues in terms of legal complexity. I also think it's important, again, to go back to what do children and young people think about these bits of legal complexity. And for me, this is complete learning of the importance of listening to children and young people. In my preparation for today, I was looking back at the minutes to the Strategic Implementation Board. And in the Strategic Implementation Board, I'd raised concerns that children and young people might not know when their rights are protected by the UNC and when they're not, how they might be able to access remedy and redress and how they're not. Since speaking to children and young people about that specific concern, they've said to me, do you know when your rights are protected by different laws? Do you know which laws prevent somebody from stealing your handbag when you're walking down the street? Do you have to quote these laws? No, you don't. That is the job of a lawyer. So children and young people have said the most important thing for them is that they need to know about their rights, they need to recognise when their rights are breached, and they need to know who they can complain to. And going back to Social Work Scotland and COSLA's concerns, for children and young people, the most important thing isn't whether they can speak to a lawyer and go to the courts. It's whether they have a trusting relationship with the adults around them, with teachers, with social workers, that they can say, I'm worried about my rights. I'm worried that they might have been breached. And the teacher and social worker deals with that straight away, saying, let's put this in place. Let's deal with your concern. Let's make this better. There's no legal complexity in that. It's just the relationships that social workers have. It's the relationships that teachers and public authorities have. And so that's the level that we need to be talking about. We need to be really front-loading this system to make sure that children and young people are in a safe, secure environment where they feel they've got trusted professionals they can speak to about their concerns. And really, the legal complexities only really matter in the most serious and extreme of cases.
Thank you. Are you OK?
Please do. I think that was a helpful contribution in terms of understanding. I think it was put by you, Julia, as the carrot and stick approach, and actually that overarching sense that people should be doing this anyway. I wonder, though, because there has been concerns raised by COSLA and Police Scotland and others about the potential kind of confusion between what is statutory and what's not statutory. And then I think in a time of ever diminishing resource and challenges for public sector bodies in particular, how do we ensure that the points that you made, Nicola, about communication, about taking rights-based approaches generally and training, and I think going to Juliet's point she just made there, how do you ensure that frontline professionals who are struggling with the day-to-day caseload are able to implement that? So, I mean, what more do you think we need to see of government in terms of putting that forward? And I wonder if I can maybe ask Nicola that first, convener, and then if Juliet wanted to comment.
I guess I'm going to reiterate some of the points that I made in the last response there. I think from Scottish Government, there is a really consistent and clear ask around about commitment to the legislative review and audit. And I think that will be supportive. I think it needs really clear leadership across all duty bearers to ensure that frontline workers know that actually the change for them is to continue to ensure that they deliver excellent services for children and young people, and that there shouldn't be a diversion of funding and support into lawyers looking at this. It is actually about the support for children and young people. Ultimately, though, if there are children's rights being breached and those are serious breaches, we want to know that as well. We want to know that, just not myself in my office, but as a society. We have to understand that, and we have to make plans to be able to do it. So I think the Scottish Government, really clear commitment to that review and audit, really clear communications, commitment to the ongoing implementation plan. So there has been a programme of work now for a number of years, and there's been excellent examples of work undertaken by duty bearers to prepare for this and to change ways of working. So a clear commitment to that from a resource point of view as well. But overall, I think really good leadership, so frontline workers know that their job is and continues to be to ensure to provide the best services for children and young people, and where they feel they're struggling with resource to do that, for that to be communicated clearly and for everyone to be listening to that.
Thank you. I do want to move on. I am going to move on because we are precious for time, and I know that members are going to be covering some of the points that may well come up, so you will get an opportunity. I'd like to bring in Megan, please.
Thank you, Convener, and a warm welcome to the panel this morning. If I could start with a reflective question, because it has been almost 2 years since the Supreme Court ruling, and it has taken that length of time for the Scottish Government to bring the amendments back to the Scottish Parliament for reconsideration. So I'm just wondering, in terms of the feedback that you've had from children and young people, or indeed your own feedback, are you disappointed with the length of time it's taken for the amendments to come back to be reconsidered? And I'm just happy to throw out Gina and Nicola, please.
I think it would be fair to say that we've had extensive frustration from children and young people about the delay. I think what's caused most of an issue for them is a lack of understanding of what's been happening in that time period. And it has been a challenge for us to have information to be able to share with them candidly about what's being considered, what the challenges are, what the progress will be and what the timetable will be for us hearing about the next steps for the bill. It has been something our office has been fairly vocal about, that the length of time has been quite challenging for children and young people. Although we do recognise that where we are now, the communication and the effort around communication does appear to be improving. It is making it, I think it has been recognised by children and young people that there is an intention to try and share information more meaningfully with them now.
Thank you. Juliet?
Yeah, so I've spoken widely to children and young people about this, and I've also been working with children and young people on this for 14 years, so many of them are now adults. So I have to say that, yes, there is quite a degree of frustration that it has taken so long. But there is also an understanding. Children and young people aren't stupid. They do understand that this is complicated and it has far-reaching consequences. I've spoken to members of the Children's Parliament, Amima and Arden, who actually came out to speak to the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child this summer about incorporation. And they said to me just the other evening, we know it will take ages for things to change. There are so many things that children are affected by. Most children just want to know that the adults are trying. We know it won't happen overnight, but we just want to know that people are trying and things are starting to change. I also spoke to members of the Scottish Youth Parliament, to Beau, Chris and Isla, and they said, it's a big change that we're looking for. We know that. And we know it will take a lot of effort from a lot of people, and change is likely to be slow. I have to say that children and young people really do appreciate it when they hear directly from people with power, from decision makers, and have updates. I think the reason why I had Shirley-Anne Spider with me today is because the Cabinet Secretary wrote to children and young people just a couple of weeks ago to update them on where we're at with the UNCRC bill. So I think when things are complicated, when things take time, as long as we're open and we communicate and we talk to children and young people, they do understand that change takes a while. But I have to say, 14 years is rather a long time.
No, thank you. And it's useful to know as well that communication is now happening between the Cabinet Secretary and young people, because that is vitally important, particularly as we move towards hopefully getting the bill over the line, because that's the crucial element here, and this is why we're back discussing this issue. If I could move on to, and it's to pick up on the points that Paul was raising about COSLA and Social Work Scotland, and Juliet, you mentioned it briefly in your last contribution as well about redress, because that has been a concern raised by COSLA, that children could find it difficult to identify when they can seek redress for UNCRC incompatibilities using the powers in the bill. So I'm just wondering what your thoughts are on how the Scottish Government can ensure that all children who are deserving of redress receive it. And Juliet, if I could start with yourself, please.
Yes, certainly. So again, this is something that I spoke to children and young people about, and they were very clear that they don't need to know which laws protect their rights at different times. The most important thing for them is that they know that they have rights, of the rights in the UNCRC, that they're able to recognise when they're breached, and that they know what they can do, who they can speak to, who they can complain to. They also talked to me a lot that sometimes children and young people are scared about complaining. They're nervous about it. They don't want to get people into trouble. So for them, the most important thing was actually that they had lots of options. They could complain anonymously. They could perhaps have a peer mentor at school, a child or young person that they could speak to about concerns of their rights. So they were really clear about that, and that actually they don't need to know the details of the laws. They need to know the details of their rights. They did suggest things like flowcharts that both children and young people and the adults around them should have, because they said that sometimes adults don't know that they have to listen to complaints from children and young people. And if they do make complaints, they're not always respected and that they're not always taken into account. So if there were flowcharts for children and young people in their schools, that they knew who to speak to informally, first of all, if they were worried about their rights, that would help them. And I think the same would be the case within children's hearings and all aspects of children and young people's lives. And it's so important that the adults around them know what to do if a child complains about their rights, because the very worst thing that can happen is that children and young people raise a worry and the adults around them don't react. So again, kind of the COSLR, I mean, I spoke to children specifically about the COSLR and Social Work Scotland concerns, and they said they're not concerns for them. They don't worry about knowing when and where their rights are, about how their rights are protected. For them, it's more important about knowing about their rights and what they can do to raise any worries that they have.
And I think that goes back to as well the element that children might be expecting something that they can see visibly. And that's where the flowcharts would come into that. I'm just wondering if there's any other comments on the redress. Gina, thank you.
I think just to build on what Juliet said there, in terms of what we can do to support address some of those concerns from COSLA and Social Work Scotland, we really recognise that the trusted adults and professionals around children and young people need to understand, which means we need to support capacity building support for those professionals to ensure that they understand what their obligations are and what rights children have and how they can be supported. So we would encourage Scottish Government to ensure that they adequately resource and support the ongoing implementation programme for the UNCRC. There has been years of extensive work already which has happened to get us to this point, but we would want to see that continue with particular emphasis on services like the Improvement Service, which are creating fantastic professional development capacity, training opportunities for adults that are working around children and young people.
Thank you. I appreciate time's precious, convener. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move straight on to Fulton, who is joining us online.
Thank you, convener. Hoping that everybody can hear me there. Good morning to the whole panel, and thank you very much for your input so far. I particularly liked your opening statement, Juliet. I think it was something a wee bit different there, and definitely the theme of the day. I've got two broad questions, the second of which we've covered a wee bit already, but in terms of my first question, the bill provides that it will commence 6 months after royal assent. What do you think as a panel about the timing of this? Do you think that's a sufficient time for duty bearers and right holders to prepare for this approach? What's your thoughts on that? And because I'm not in the room, convener, I'm really happy for you to convene who answers.
Juliet.
Thank you for that question. And together, members are very clear that they are happy with the six-month commencement date. This is building on the fact that the UK signed up to the UNCRC in 1991. Policy in Scotland under GERFEC has built on the UNCRC, and that's been since 2006. If the bill had commenced after being unanimously passed by the Scottish Parliament back in March 2021, it would have commenced by now. And so actually there's been a lot of time for the implementation programme that Gina has spoken about to build the capacity of public bodies to actually be ready for this stage now, to be ready for implementation. The UNCRC implementation programme is obviously, it's been funded since March 2021. It's so important that that is continued to make sure that duty bearers are ready for commencement. At the moment, it's only funded up to March of next year. And so this is one of our specific asks to the Cabinet Secretary, that she commits to continue this funding for the UNCRC implementation programme. This has been providing, as Gina said, vital support through the Improvement Service for public bodies and for elected members. It's enabled the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman to develop a child-friendly complaints mechanism, which is currently being piloted across lots of local authorities. It's allowed time for the UNCRC Innovation Fund, in which public bodies are trialling approaches at the moment towards UNCRC implementation. It's allowed some brilliant work by the Scottish Youth Parliament, their rights, the Rights Now resource, and the Dignity in Schools Hub from the Children's Parliament. So that all of this wouldn't have been in place if it had commenced back when the bill was first passed. So I would say we're more than capable, we're more than prepared to cope with 6 months commencement at this point.
Okay, thank you. Any other in there? Fulton, I'll come back to you, please. I don't think he can. Oh, he can't hear me.
Sorry, I was waiting to be unmuted there. Convener, thank you very much. Thanks very much for that. And I think, Joy, you did probably answer. And I could see everybody nodding that was on the panel. So I think there's general agreement there. My second question builds on from that. And I know we have talked about it a wee bit. And this is about, you know, what duty bearers should be doing anyway. And there has obviously been the suggestion that we've heard today already that duty bearers should be acting compatibly with the UNCRC requirements, regardless of the amendments to the bill. Does that view make the amended bill easier then for duty bearers to navigate, or do you think there's a danger that public authorities might now focus more in areas that could potentially be litigated on? Have you got any thoughts on that?
Thank you. Can I bring in Jan, please?
Yep. So I think it would be really disappointing if that were to be the case, and it's really quite a concern in PRISM to look through the bill. The point of this bill is, in many respects, as we've heard across the panel, to reaffirm what should be happening anyway. So the state, the United Kingdom, through the duty bearers here in Scotland, ratified the UNCRC many years ago. Duty bearers should already be, and in many cases are, delivering and designing services which promote compliance with the treaty. So I think there's a question to be asked as to why duty bearers may feel that that might not be the case, and to be explored around why that's the case, and what support and resources they would need to remedy that. If the process through increased routes of strategic litigation, for example, which will only be in the most severe and systemic cases of human rights violations to be tested through the courts, if that is a result of this bill, then that has got to be a good thing, because that has to then guide duty bearers as to what they need to do to make things better. And the point of strategic litigation is that that does not then just apply to the child and in the local authority or in the town and the community where that has been experienced, but that the learning through the court system then as a test case can apply across the rest of the country. The bill isn't about going to court every 5 minutes, you know, and we'll talk about that as we progress through the Human Rights Bill process too, but it's about creating the context where there is opportunity for those systemic and strategic risks to be tested through the court system. And I think the final point to say, we've talked a lot about capacity building and the difference of approach and supportive approach, actually, that this bill and its supporting guidance can bring to bear in terms of informing how public services are designed and delivered. But at the Commission, we do a lot of work around capacity building on a human rights-based approach to budgeting and to service design. And what you see is where public services get that right and where duty bearers are coalescing everything around the human rights of individuals, then outcomes for those individuals improve. Reliance on public services decreases. And actually, there's an opportunity there to redistribute areas of focus. So I think it would be a disappointing prism for duty bearers to look at it through that lens.
Thank you. Juliet, briefly, please.
Very briefly. I think it's important to reiterate that many of Together's members will be duty bearers under the new bill. We specifically fought for an amendment at stage two of the UNCRC bill to make sure that those who are delivering public services on behalf of government are included within the scope of the Act. So we're not going into this kind of blind. We know that we as organisations, Together itself, will have obligations under the new bill. But when we're going into it, we're also very mindful of the need to address children's rights across the board. And we're not focusing on where there's possible litigation. What we're doing is making sure that we're getting things right from the outset. And I think it's with that spirit that Together members are hoping that we see that as well across public bodies, that we want to act compatibly across the board. We want to get things right from the outset, but we also want to be covered by that Section 6 duty so that there is accountability, there is scrutiny where we don't get things right.
Juliet, can I just ask you then, so the government, the Scottish Government has committed to a 3-year implementation plan. Do you think that that is reasonable and realistic, bearing in mind what you've just said about getting it right from the beginning to avoid the litigation coming forward?
So the 3-year implementation plan has already started. So that is the UNCRC implementation programme that I spoke about with the improvement service. So I think that has given us plenty of time to prepare. But at the same time, I do think it's really important that we get a continued commitment to that implementation programme for the next 3 years, so that when the duties are live, we're continuing to build our capacity and to develop and to learn.
That's great. Thank you. Thank you for saying that. Fulton, I take it that you have no further supplementaries, and thank you. I'd like to bring in Maggie, please.
Thanks very much, Kirkhaven, and good morning to the panel. Thank you very much for being here and for your contributions, both in writing previously and today. I want to just pick up on a couple of the legal complexity issues that both Paul O'Kane and Megan Gallagher have spoken about. Juliet, you said earlier that, you know, children and young people don't need to know which rights are being breached and under which, sorry, they don't need to know which laws or where things are going wrong, but they need to know what their rights are. And I suppose this, given the partial coverage that we will have with a proposed amendments, there will be gaps. Are you concerned, or are any of your members concerned, that those gaps will lead to a mismatch of expectation and reality into how we can actually tackle issues when there is a breach, when something does go wrong?
Juliet, come to you first.
Yeah, definitely. And that's why it's not so much a mismatch of expectation. It's more about the practicalities. Okay. And it's more about making sure as well that there is full coverage of protections for children's rights across the board. And I think three of our asks that we've made to the Cabinet Secretary particularly address this point and the concerns that have been raised by COSLA and Social Work Scotland. So it is why we know the Cabinet Secretary has committed to conduct a legislative review to see what's covered by the bill and what isn't. We want a timescale for that. We want to know when that legislative review is going to happen. And we also want a commitment to actions. We want really that commitment that we are going to bring as much into scope as possible. I mean, our second ask is to continue to use legislative opportunities to bring things in the scope of the bill. So we have forthcoming opportunities with the Promise Scotland bill, with the Education Scotland bill, where provisions, like one of our members has described them as mothership provisions that you always come back to if you're taking a legal case. So if you bring those provisions in through the Promise Scotland bill and through the Education Scotland bill, that will help to address this point as well. And the final of these 3 points that I think are particularly relevant to this question is about committing to minimise the use of amendments to UK acts in future legislation. So an example for this is one that we don't have the time to address, but in the Children's Care and Justice Bill, it makes amendments to 5 significant UK acts, and they will be out with the scope of the UNCRC bill. So it means as the Scottish Parliament continues to legislate, we're going to end up with a more complex legal landscape.
this is really important for preparation for the Human Rights Bill of for Scotland as well, that we want to make sure that as much is included within Acts of the Scottish Parliament as possible, because it makes a clearer legislative landscape. So we are asking for a commitment from the Cabinet Secretary to minimise amendments to UK Acts and instead to actually make these amendments on the face of Acts of the Scottish Parliament, so we have that clarity in law. And that's useful for children, young people, for duty bearers and for lawyers.
Thanks, Juliet. That's really clear. And I mean, I suppose it's very, very clear that this is a journey, as you've said before, and you know, we're not stopping here. I suppose in that, are there approaches or are there things that you and your members would like to see happen, either by the Scottish Government, by other duty bearers, and I recognise that many of your members are duty bearers too. What approaches can we make? Can we have? What guidance are you looking for to ensure that we actually have that overview, even if things aren't completely covered, although we hope coverage will increase over time?
So that's where, again, the holistic approach that's been taken to drafting the bill, the fact that we've got reporting duties and we've got the Children's Rights Scheme, provides a mechanism through ministers can be held to account on the steps that they're taking to ensure that legislation is drafted within Acts of the Scottish Parliament as much as possible, and that steps are taken to address the findings of the legislative review. The ministers can actually report through the reporting scheme every year of what they've been doing. It can be included as an action within the Children's Rights Scheme. And I think really importantly, something again that members of the Scottish Youth Parliament have stressed with me, then they need to be involved in this decision. And so when Scottish Government have done their legislative review, when they've looked to see what is out of scope of the bill, that's where we need to balance the legislative opportunities that we have with the priorities that children and young people have identified to make sure that that continual law reform is really informed by children and young people's experiences of their rights.
Thanks very much, Juliet. My second question is around the requirements, and Jan, I'll come to you on this first. It's for both you and Nicola. As commissions, you will be given additional responsibilities and powers with this, and I suppose this is important as we look ahead to the human rights legislation too. How will the amended bill affect your current work, and what additional resources, what additional expertise and skills will you and your organisations need to make sure that when you are required to take legal action, you actually can do so in a meaningful way?
Okay, thank you. So yes, we welcome the new powers very much that have been proposed for the SHRC via the CRC bill. As committee members will be aware, they would give the Scottish Human Rights Commission and the Children's Commissioner the power to raise own name proceedings, so that strategic litigation that we've been speaking about, and to intervene in proceedings where there is a public authority has acted in a way that is made unlawful by the bill. And over time, that will increase. So that might be the first challenge is that as the framework increases and as that web gets smaller, that actually the requirements on each commission to do so will change. We don't currently have the powers to raise proceedings in our own name to challenge any systemic human rights violations in Scotland. It's a clear gap compared to how human rights are enjoyed in other countries of the United Kingdom. So we see this as a really important first step to open that door for the Scottish Human Rights Commission that we can explore further via the Human Rights Bill in due course. There's provision, and we've had early discussions across both offices. As I said earlier, it's specifically stated in our legislation that we must not duplicate the efforts of other public bodies, so it will be incumbent upon us to continue to communicate closely on how and when each organisation would seek it to be appropriate to use those powers. And that feels appropriate, actually, because children's rights are everyone's rights, so all human rights have an impact on children and young people, and each organisation will have its own strategic plan, its own strategic priorities, and there will be issues that will be of more strategic concern to either organisation at any given time. I think having the potential across both organisations also helps us to just manage the potential workload that will arise. And so, yeah, we've started those early considerations. It will be important not to duplicate, but we very, very much welcome it.
Thanks. Gina or Nicola, do you want to
comment? Yep, and just to echo some of Jan's points, we very much welcome the additional powers. What I wanted to emphasise as well is the office has already been spending time, even before I was in post, preparing for this. So earlier in the year, we published a strategic litigation toolkit. This was developed with international experts and children and young people, and it's available publicly so people can understand actually those powers and how the office may use them in the future. And we want to ensure that's as transparent as possible and that people understand that it will be based on strategic priorities, the best interests of children and young people. So the office has been in preparation for a number of years around about this. Also, one of the very first things I had to do was propose how we would use our budget for next financial year. So we've already made preparations and plans of how we would be able to allocate resources effectively for that.
Okay, thanks. And Fiona, I don't know if you wanted to come in on this point as well, that the statutory obligations that the Law Society has, do you see any need for thinking differently in your work?
It's not something that we have specifically looked at, and with that lens, I think that is probably specifically for the two organisations that you've spoken to. Again, on your previous question, just in terms of, I think I've already covered what's been said about the complexities and gaps, and we would echo that the government could provide detailed guidance. We would support a legislative review, and we'd also be supportive of post-legislative scrutiny in the term of having a legislative audit as well.
Okay, thanks. And we can, I'm sure the conversations will carry on about exactly what needs to be in that guidance. So I'll leave it there for now.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Maggie. I'd like to bring in Annie, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Just going on the legislative audit, and Nicola, you had mentioned that a couple of times as well. And I was just wondering, what do you think should be included in it? Who should be involved with it? How long you think it might take? And whether there could be unintended consequences to it?
And Jules, I think, are you happy to come in on this first?
Yeah.
Happy to come in on this first. So this is something that we have been asking for quite a time. And it is something that actually happens in most countries that incorporate the UNCRC. It doesn't always happen before the bill commences, it often happens afterwards, and there are examples of Sweden and Norway around that. So in terms of what's involved, first of all, we want Scottish Government to set out the timescale. We want them to concentrate, first of all, on the legislative review, so what is in and what is out of scope of the bill. At that point, we want them to look at the legislative opportunities that we have. So we've mentioned the Promise Bill and education reform as examples, and see what we can bring in. And we want them to speak to children and young people to look for other opportunities to bring in other bits of legislation that are particularly important to them. So in terms of involvement at that stage, then it's very much Scottish Government, children and young people, for us together, members and the Commissioner and SHRC. And it is something that they could work with the Scottish Law Commission on as well. There's a good starting point, actually, with the concluding observations that come from the UNCRC as well for the subsequent legislative audits. The review is looking at what's in and out of the bill. The legislative audit afterwards is a compatibility review. So where we've got all the laws that protect children's rights in Scotland, are they all compliant with the UNCRC? And we would say this is actually something that can be done further down the road. The most important thing at the moment is the review of what's in and out. The audit itself that can be done further down the road should involve stakeholders from all across Scotland, children and young people, commissioners, etc., like we've said. And we do know already of examples of legislation that our members have highlighted as not being compatible with the UNCRC. We know there are provisions in criminal justice for 16 and 17-year-olds which are not compatible with the UNCRC. We know in the Education Scotland Act, the fact that children up to the age of 18 can't opt out of religious observance, that's not compatible with the UNCRC. The Marriage Scotland Act is not compatible with the UNCRC. But for us, in terms of priority, do the legislative review, find out what's in and out, look for opportunities to bring things into scope of the bill, and over time we can do that compatibility review, which, as I say, even in countries like in Norway, that was 11 years after they incorporated the UNCRC, and that's an ongoing piece of work to check compatibility with legislation.
Perfect.
And I think my other question I was going to ask has been answered earlier on, so for time I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Thanks very much. We will move on to Karen, please.
Great. Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. As you're all probably aware, the Scottish Government does have plans to introduce a Scottish Human Rights Bill. And this is going to incorporate four international treaties in human rights treaties into law. Dr. Tickell, who's joining us in panel two, has said that the difficulties facing the UNCRC bill apply just as powerfully to further incorporation. So with that in mind, and I think I'm probably looking to Fiona and Jan, what do you think the Scottish Government, the Parliament, our duty bearers, rights holders, learn from these UNCRC bill amendments? And how will this apply to our Scottish Human Rights Bill?
Fiona?
There are undoubtedly lessons to be learned looking forward in terms of the Human Rights Bill. One thing that some have picked up on is the potential for a new approach to be taken in terms of drafting, where existing legislation isn't amended, but the decision is taken to re-legislate with a new Scottish Act. We would need to look at this in more detail. Freestanding provisions rather than amendment of previous UK legislation could have the benefit of being within scope of the UNCRC compliance duties. It's possible they would be easier for legislators and others to understand when bills are being enacted. However, we've also heard the concern around usability of legislation. So the benefit of textual amendment is that all relevant statutory provisions can be found in one place, and people operating the relevant schemes only need to know about the main statute rather than having to take account of a range of provisions. That's potentially why the preference is right now is likely for textual amendments. So we would have to look at that in more detail if we did see that change to form a view on that. We responded to the recent human rights consultation, and when we were talking about the proposed models, noted that in order to ensure the bill is within the competence of the Scottish Parliament, the text of the treaties would need to be amended to remove anything which could relate to reserved matters contained within the Scotland Act. So that's an initial example of where you'd need to have regard to the problems faced in that process. Obviously, we've only seen the consultation at this stage, so we would need to see more in terms of the approach that ends up being taken towards a future bill.
That's great. I appreciate that. John, do you want to?
So first things first, we really need this bill process, so the CRC amendment bill process, to conclude and to conclude successfully. It's really important that the bill is progressed without further delay in order that we can fully learn all of the lessons of this process before we apply that to the Human Rights Bill. Your job as the Scottish Parliament is, you know, the guarantors of human rights legislation, realisation and fulfilment for the people of Scotland, and it's our job at the Commission to be alongside you every step of that journey and support you with that role. We know now, as a result of the first lesson learned from the CRC process, is there is a big curtailment on the ability of the Scottish Parliament to progressively legislate in all areas of human rights in the way that it thought it could. But the positive element of the Supreme Court ruling is that it is possible for the Scottish Parliament to incorporate human rights treaties into Scots law. That's a really important first principle that we sometimes can forget when we go back to the complexities of how we do that. It's the how that's changed. The why hasn't changed. You know, you'll be legislating to enhance protections for individuals and communities directly into Scots law, and that must always be the guiding principle through this, as we've explored today around the Children's Rights Bill. But clearly, this process is going to have significant implications for the design of the bill. It's difficult, as we've explained. We haven't yet seen a a proposed draft bill from the Scottish Government. We have a consultation, which we've all participated in. And at this stage, we haven't seen the legal advice from the Scottish Government in terms of what's informing their current considerations. What we have done is the Commission has published a statement about the proposed bill and a legal opinion from senior counsel on the incorporation approach, which deals with a lot of the complexities which Fiona helpfully from the Law Society has outlined. We've shared both of those in writing with the committee, and at an appropriate time, as you wish, we will be very, very happy as a team to come back and engage further with the committee on that. Our view at present, in summary, is that the proposed approach has not necessarily yet fully learned all of the lessons from this process. And that might be understandable because the process hasn't yet concluded. But it's very important to signpost that to you. It is definitely possible to look at alternative models of incorporation. And again, the legal opinion that we have sought and shared with you encourages that. And at this stage, we are not in a position to specify what particular approach over any other may be the best. But we need to signal that there are alternative approaches to incorporation which could better achieve the policy intent, which is excellent. The policy intent of the Human Rights Bill is absolutely excellent. And all any of us are really concerned with now is moving forward from this process and ensuring that we have the most justiciable, foreseeable bill that provides clarity for everyone. The clarity of scope we've outlined. So the legislative audit process, which again Juliet has really eloquently outlined for the purposes of the CRC bill. We didn't know that was going to have to be done when the CRC bill was drafted. We now know that is going to have to be done ahead of the Human Rights Bill. So let's be ready for that. And I think that would be one ask. Yes, it can be a progressive process, but there's definitely an earlier consideration that's possible now around prioritising, shining a spotlight on those areas of human rights legislation that Parliament may wish to look at sooner rather than later. I think we're also clear now that we have to be in it for the long term. So this is not going to be a quick fix through the Human Rights Bill. And the opportunity now is to open a door for a longer term development. And we will come back absolutely in due course to consider that more fully with you.
Yeah, Nicola, please.
Just have one thing to add, and it's just what I hope children and young people will learn from this in the future. And that it is that we won't give up, and that the Scottish Parliament will continue to ensure that you can do everything you can to promote and safeguard their rights.
Thank you. Karen, was there anything further?
Nothing on that. That was really helpful. Thank you. Thank you very much. I have another question, Karina, if that's okay.
You have another question?
Not another question, yeah.
Yes, please.
Yeah. Thank you. It was just us. This is our evidence session on the UNCRC bill. And it was to ask, along with yourselves and a second panel today, if you feel that is enough for us as a committee to be doing. And if not, is there anyone that you feel that we should be hearing from?
Juliet?
Yes. Yes, I think there's somebody else that needs to be in the room. And this is, again, demonstrating to me the importance of listening to people with lived experience and duty bearers, because I have to hold my hands up. I have to say I thought this was too complicated for children and young people. I thought, don't consult with children and young people on the specifics of what's in and out, and don't speak to children and young people about whether this law is important or that. And I've learnt in the past 6 weeks that they have plenty to say, and they have plenty to say about the practicalities. And so that's why I've underpinned all my evidence with children and young people. And I think those children and young people I've spoken to have spoken to their peers, and I do think that we've managed to get across a lot of what they've told me. But they've taught me a lot just in preparing for this session. And I think we always need to have people with lived experience in the room, even if it seems tough and complex. And I think the specific examples around that, my assumption that children and young people wouldn't want to be involved, the kind of assumptions that we've got from COSLA and Social Work Scotland, that children and young people would be worried about which laws protect their rights when. All of these are things that I've learned from children and young people. Some of our concerns aren't concerns to children and young people. And sometimes they have concerns that we haven't even thought about. Yeah. But I do hope that the children and young people I've spoken to feel that I've properly represented them today.
I think you did a wonderful job. Thank you.
Does anybody else have anything to come in on that one? Okay, so I think on behalf of the committee, I think we've found this a very useful session. I think we've managed to get under the skin of some of the areas of contention in making sure that we move on at pace, but we also provide a very thorough scrutiny process alongside that. And Julia, I think we all appreciated you bringing alive the children's voices in a practical way and using the spider and the web. I suppose from our point of view, we want to make sure that that web is robust enough. So in the future, when we're adding all the bits and things on to strengthen children's rights, that this framework that we have, this web we have now, is going to be robust enough to carry that. And I suppose from my point of view, I would have to agree that children are well able to understand complicated concepts regarding their own needs and their wants and their rights. When I was teaching prior to being elected, we were doing rights respecting schools and the articles in the UNCRC, and children were able to not only orally but also through pictures, through multi-sensory play, they were able to well express their knowledge around all the different articles. And in one sense, it appears that they were well ahead of us adults, and the legislative process is just catching up with them. So in the spirit of that, thank you very much for your contributions this morning. It will certainly add to our scrutiny. Thank you very much. And I suspend the meeting very briefly in order to allow for a change of panellists. happen yet. Thank you. We will now resume with our next panel of witnesses. And I welcome to the meeting this morning Councillor Tony Buchanan, Children and Young People Board spokesperson from COSLA. Welcome. I'd also like to welcome Derek Frew, who is the temporary Chief Superintendent, Head of Partnerships, Prevention and Community Wellbeing from Police Scotland. And I'd like to welcome Dr. Andrew Tickell, who is the Senior Lecturer in Law at Glasgow Caledonian University. Welcome to all three of you this morning, and thank you very much for joining us. I will invite each of our witnesses this morning to make any brief opening remarks, should they wish to do so, before we move to questions from myself and the rest of my committee members. And I'd like to start with Councillor Buchanan, please.
Thank you, Chair. Happy to make an opening statement and good morning to everyone. In fact, yes, still good morning. And thank you for the opportunity to give evidence today. And already we have responded in writing to you previously. But firstly, I think it's important to be clear that local government is fully supportive of the intentions of UNCRC Incorporation. We share the vision of a Scotland where children's human rights are embedded and fulfilled across all public services, and extensive work is already underway across all councils to take forward this ambition. Local government's concerns are not about the incorporation itself, but rather about the practical implications for councils of the proposed amendment to the UNCRC compatibility duty, whereby it would apply only where an authority is acting under an Act of the Scottish Parliament and not UK legislation. These concerns have been raised by our professional advisers representing social work, education and local authority solicitors. We are concerned that the approach will leave considerable gaps in the legal protection of children's rights. Key areas of council services and functions will be excluded from the scope of the UNCRC legislation, including within some of the key relevant areas, such as education and care and protection. Another key concern is around the significant legal complexity this will bring. Council's powers and functions are based in a complex mix of both Scottish and UK acts, meaning that the nature of the compatibility duty on local authorities may, in many situations, be complicated and unclear. This complexity will pose difficulties for operability and accessibility, both for practitioners applying the legislation, as well as children and young people and their advocates seeking to understand and claim their rights. In line with the Verity House Agreement, local government is committed to working in close partnership with the Scottish Government and other partners in resolving these concerns. There are a number of things the Scottish Government can do to help address these, namely to undertake an exercise to identify which public authority functions will be in and out of scope, provide detailed sector-specific guidance for public authorities, and ensure there is a very clear public messaging about the limited coverage and the amended legislation itself. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony. Could I bring in Dr. Andrew Tickell, please?
Great. Well, thank you. Nice to be with you here this morning, here again. I suppose I should say at the beginning that I'm not a children's rights specialist, so my interest in this topic really is fundamentally about devolution, how devolution functions, and the practicalities of what this means in terms of this bill for the enforceability of these rights. So that's my starting point. And although I enjoyed your discussion at the end about children's perspective on this, I'm not sure, to be a cynic about it, that I entirely agreed with you, Convener, that this is an area where children can understand this issue, because I think I've given evidence in Parliament in writing or in person about 10 times now. And I can't think of an occasion where drafting a short written statement about what a bill or even just amendments to part of it would do was more difficult to try and make simple and clear and understandable than what I tried to do in preparation for this particular process. Because I think it's very difficult to get your head around these amendments, the consequences of that. So I suppose you might find my evidence on this somewhat negative. I think the first panel accentuated the positive, and understandably so, but I suppose I'm going to be accentuating the negative here today, not least simply to make clear what you are and aren't doing, because that, of course, is what legislation is about. It's about setting down law which will be usable or unusable in practice. And I think there's lots of positive things about the bill. There are a range of practical things that colleagues have identified about how some of the problems that we're going to talk about can be addressed. But I don't want us to skip past the fact that the UK Supreme Court judgment, which surprised many academic lawyers in its breadth of approach to this Parliament's legislative competence, has significantly impacted on your capacity to introduce significant human rights protection, not just in this area, but as we'll perhaps develop later, on a range of other forms of human rights that you will be contemplating in due course. So I say that not as a counsel of despair or of woe, but of realism, I think, about what this bill can and cannot achieve. But it's interesting to be here with you again, and hopefully I can help you in your deliberations.
Thank you. Chief Superintendent.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, and thank you for the invitation to attend today's committee and the opportunity to provide you with Police Scotland's views of the amended bill. Police Scotland is a rights-based organisation with our values of fairness, integrity and respect, and a commitment to upholding human rights at the heart of everything that we do. So upholding the rights of children and young people as set out in the UNCRC is aligned to our existing approaches and aspirations, which will be further underpinned by embedding UNCRC into our policies and procedures. As has been highlighted today, this specific legislation does contain complexities in terms of its application, some of which have been addressed through the amendments, and we are committed to continue to work collaboratively to resolve the challenges that require to be addressed from a policing context. The committee will be aware that the current financial challenges facing Police Scotland and other public bodies are resulting in hard choices being made to deliver services, and we are no exception. We are making those hard choices to deliver effective policing within our current funding parameters. And as the public would expect, we are prioritising our resources in those areas of greatest demand and risk to ensure our overall commitment to keep people safe. So legislative changes like this ultimately bring with it a human resource commitment with a potential recurring impact on our revenue budget. It is also recognised that the scope of the bill may also have wider implications on our capital budget. So it's essential that we fully understand Scottish Government and key partners' expectations of the police, balanced against the mandatory legislative requirements of the bill to ensure compliance at the date of enactment. Therefore, going forward, it's important that we collectively understand what Police Scotland can and will deliver within the resourcing landscape and legislative landscape that we're currently operating and will do when this is enacted. But I would like to conclude, as I started, by reaffirming Police Scotland's commitment to working with the Scottish Government and key partners to comply with the requirements of the amended bill and make a real and tangible difference to upholding the rights and children of young people.
Thank you very much. Andrew, let's come back to your opening statement there. And the committee welcomes your perspective on this. It is our job to scrutinise this in the widest possible sense. So we're actually on the same page, really. So what is your view of the Scottish Government's approach to responding to the Supreme Court judgment and its proposed amendments on that? Also, the previous panel, we heard their view generally was that there was no alternative. I wondered whether you had a perspective on that also.
Yeah, I think as we saw at the beginning when the bill was first passed, there were really two primary ambitions which were articulated initially. It was a maximalist approach to application within devolution and minimising complexity, both of which are very admirable goals. But I think my view is after the Supreme Court judgment and the decision that Westminster legal sources, if we can call it that, can't be subject to any of the restrictions, means you can just decide which kind of complexity and fragmentation you want to deal with, because the legislative picture is now inherently fragmented. And therefore, all the Scottish Government can do, and all you can do in deciding which approach is best, is to pick the best option. And I have to say, in considering the alternatives, it does seem to me that the Cabinet Secretary's proposals are the ones that reduce complexity to the minimum possible level at this stage. It's very commonplace, I think, for people to come before Parliament, and you'll know yourselves, with problems and critiques and saying basically you should fix it or the Scottish Government should fix it, vaguely implying that there's some wonderful solution out there to these problems. I don't think there is any solution to the UK Supreme Court's judgment above and beyond what the Scottish Government has proposed. However, it does have all of the consequences that Councillor Buchanan also outlined. So there is no perfect solution in front of us at this stage, or significant alternative approaches to incorporation. I suppose the single issue which you could take a different approach to is on amendments. So, as you know, the Scottish Government have proposed that only acts of the Scottish Parliament should be subject to these interpretive duties, and therefore any amendments you have made to other legislation passed by Westminster shouldn't be subject to that. You could, in principle, extend your amendments to cover the UNCRC, but I think that would produce yet even more complexity than we already see in terms of the legislation in front of us. So I think the Cabinet Secretary herself recognises that as they sought to extend coverage, they also extended complexity. And that suggests to me that those noble ambitions at the beginning of maximalism and lack of complexity are not aspirations we can really pursue at this stage for this bill. So for me, given all of those compromises, the Cabinet Secretary's compromise seems the most rational and the most workable, but it still presents a range of really profound challenges for public authorities, I think, in particular, as well as for rights holders who might try and vindicate their rights through the courts.
Okay. So the word I was thinking of was pragmatic. It's a pragmatic way forward, but we realise the complexities of it. Can you give an example of sort of like maybe an unintended consequence of this process? You alluded to it about maybe a legal challenge. Could you sort of go into that a little bit more?
In terms of unintended consequences of the Scottish Government's proposals, or
yeah, the Scottish Government's proposal.
Yeah, I think in terms of what the Scottish Government has proposed is that, as I say, only acts of the Scottish Parliament will be subject to this legislation, but amendments passed by this Parliament won't be. So just imagine that you are a child, or more probably an advocate for a child, who thinks you've got a legal issue with an act of the Scottish Parliament. And you go and you find the act there and you think, oh good, it's in this legislation. But then you discover it's an amendment to a Westminster bill and therefore is out with the scope of the UNCRC. Right. It's undoubtedly the case that children will look at that, whether it's about the Education Scotland Act 1980, whether it's about the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 1995, they will look at that and think, these are big issues of children's rights. The Children's Scotland Act 1995 is probably the best example, covering issues of adoption and so forth. It will strike people as difficult to understand why something as fundamental to the rights of children as adoption falls outside the scope of the rights protected by the UNCRC. And that is the net effect of what the Scottish Government is proposing. I think that's probably the perversity or potential gap in the law, you can put it more or less strongly, that you were alluding to before, and which really has the biggest implications for the enforceability of this legislation at the moment. Maybe I can say more positively later on, but the complexity will decrease over time. But it begins in a very complex place, I think.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Do any of the other panellists want to come in on that area? It was very specific, I suppose. I can move on to Maggie, please.
Okay. Thanks very much, Kirkab, and good morning to the three of you. Thank you for joining us today. I want to just drill down into some of those legal complexities and I suppose the impacts, primarily, Tony, for local government and Derek for Police Scotland. Tony, in your opening statement, you talked about the close partnership working that you have had and you hope will continue around working out some of the concerns around identifying for you, for the public, for everybody, which functions are in and out. I suppose a question, and this maybe echoes some of the points we heard earlier. We know that, you know, the legal redress side of these things is only one component of the legislation. There's a whole host of other bits within UNCRC and within other legislation that is about rights protections for children and young people. And I suppose, given that duty bearers are encouraged and asked to act in compliance anyway, can you just unpick a little bit more about the exact complexities and tensions that you've identified, and whether there are things that we can consider, given that overall point that we should be complying anyway?
Yeah, I think, I mean, it's very difficult because, you know, as Andrew touched on, there are things which might have consequentials that happen after the event, if you like, and that makes it a very difficult place to begin with. What we're trying to do just now is flag up many of the concerns. For example, we envision an amended bill being significantly more difficult to navigate because of the narrowed compatibility duty and the need for legal obligations to be clear and practically applicable. And that can go for both authorities and all of our partners. So there is a huge gap there in what we can potentially set aside and potentially do. Our professional advisers at the moment have advised that, including Solace, Solar and ADES, and Social Work Scotland, have advised that they envisage some significant practical challenges for the implementation in terms of the need for staff to interpret and apply the legal duties, which will now involve some significant additional complexity. And that could result in capacity issues for legal and other departments in local authorities due to the required work that might be then required through the legislative issues of dealing with that. And again, that strain in capacity would also have likely related financial implications, as again has been touched on. So we are clear that sufficient time is required for local authorities to prepare to implement the amended duties, and that this will require timely provision of detailed guidance, which again we come back to ensuring that we have that guidance so that we can narrow the parameters, if you like, of what we have.
That's helpful. Just in terms of that guidance, in the conversations that you, COSLA, and others have had, do you get the sense that there's a shared understanding across different partners of what that guidance actually needs to say?
Well, I think there's a shared understanding that we all want to see children's rights upheld and protected. But we are clear that there needs to be some very good, as I mentioned earlier, public messaging in relation to it. Mm-hmm. And we also need the detailed sector-specific guidance to enable our frontline staff to do their job. Because without that, I think we would all start to struggle. Mm-hmm. So we need that to be up front, to know what the parameters are, and to be able to set that out from day one.
Okay, thanks. That's helpful. And I suppose that links to the point that you made earlier about if we don't get the guidance right, if we don't get the resource allocation right, and I mean we collectively, not us in Parliament or you separately, do you think that there's potentially a danger that duty bearers focus on the legal elements and the bits that aren't included in incorporation because they are UK acts rather than Scottish Parliament acts? Is there a danger that we focus exclusively or to the detriment of the excluded areas in terms of providing the service because we're worried about litigation?
I suppose that the real issue is it's a potential issue. You know, and our frontline staff are going out to do the best for the children and the families and young people that they're working with. And the last thing you want is for them to come up against a barrier which doesn't enable them to take forward that action.
Okay, thanks. Derek, can I come to you? Very similar questions around the capacity issues which you've already highlighted, but really that detail around how you envisage dealing with some of those complexities, some of the gaps, the mismatch between reality and expectation that your colleagues might face as well as the people that you are looking to support.
Absolutely. And I think start with a positive, first of all, because we talked about acting in
in line with UNCRC. Yeah. I would like to think, certainly from a policing perspective, when you think about, we've been working with GIRFEC principles yeah. for a long time, the work we've done around about age of criminal responsibility, the work that we've done around about trauma-informed practice that we continue to do, the work we do about how we conduct interviews of children. There's a whole landscape of good work that's getting done yeah. in the policing context where the rights of a child are at the absolute centre of it. But I think the complexities of that litigation question, I don't think we'll focus on the litigation because of that good work that gets done. Yeah. But ultimately, that is a huge fear factor for public bodies because we absolutely want to embed this. And I think the unintended consequences of not having probably that clear legislative review, not having that clear guidance, puts us on that position where you want to make sure that we protect the organisation versus deliver the UNCRC mm-hmm. principles, which is an absolute. We're not saying that it's not there, but I think it's a natural default position for a duty bearer to look at. So I think any legislative review or guidance we could get would be really helpful because the complexities of policing, you've got cross-border investigations, you've got UK legislation, the definition of age of a child across many different ranges of legislation is different. So there is huge complexities there that probably need to be worked through. Never mind the actual embedding it in the corporate memory of what, and we'll probably touch on it later, about the child rights impact assessment and what that process looks like versus what we're provisioning in a custody environment. And what additional cost that could have if we're to keep children and adults separately. What is the utopian vision versus the reality in terms of what police estate we have? So that's just maybe a small overview of that, if that's helpful.
That is helpful. And I suppose, coming back to the point you made, the very clear ask you're making there for clear and detailed guidance, do you have concerns at the moment, given conversations that have happened to date, that actually that guidance is going to be fuzzy or absent? And I suppose, are there things that you would be looking to us as the committee scrutinising this to make very, very clear recommendations on? Because I think it's all very well to say we want clear guidance, but actually understanding what we mean by clear guidance is important.
Absolutely. I think from a policing context, certainly, because we've probably got slightly been narrow parameters than maybe COSLA will have because okay. of the range of services that they deliver. But from a policing context, it'd be useful, as Andrew described, what legislation is it that in the expectations of Scottish Government and partners that we heard in the first panel, what is it you expect us to deliver? And can we meet those expectations? And it's not just that mandatory legislative requirement, because we could very quickly go down into legislation and pick off the detail and say we are doing no more than that. And I don't think any of the public bodies or duty bearers should be doing that. We should be trying to do something more holistic without the fear of that litigation. I'm probably not giving you a definitive answer, but we want to do it more broadly, as the first panel alluded to, because that is the utopian vision. But the reality of that lack of legislative review and that sector guidance, bespoke sector guidance, that would be informed by partners that we heard in the first panel, I think would be really helpful.
That's really helpful. Thank you. Andrew, if I can come to you, my last question. I suppose just really your thoughts on that balance between how we make sure we offer guidance and support for duty bearers and other service providers, but in a way that doesn't lead to that focusing in on the litigation elements, or, you know, because for organisational protection, for a whole range of reasons that we've already discussed, what are your thoughts and comments on how we best avoid that?
Yeah, it's very interesting, isn't it? Because mm-hmm. there's the aspiration for a kind of generic mainstreaming approach would say, well, forget the technicalities, get the lawyers out of the room, they distract us and focus us on the wrong things. Whereas the demand for clarity is the exact opposite, in fact. So you probably can't service those two things in the same way. I mean, certainly if you look at empirical studies of the impact rights and law have on decision-making by public authorities, It's very often the case that the impact is through non-legal sources, through understanding of the law that are shared through professional practice and understandings of what best practice look like. I mean, it upsets lawyers, but there's lots of evidence that the law has relatively little impact on what public authorities actually do on the ground, and that might upset parliamentarians as well, I'm not sure, but that is the situation that we are in. Certainly it is the case, as in other sectors of society, that you can get almost defensive medicine. You get the situation where you have the judge on your shoulder and the anxiety that the legal department are going to get involved. So I think perceiving that as a discernible risk is absolutely right and probably not avoidable, because if the Scottish Government is to produce a long laundry list of things which public authorities definitely are subject to litigation under, I think it's unavoidable that they will be approached differently than broad aspirational principles which are less articulated.
There's a danger there that undermines the sort of culture of compliance that we are wanting to support, we are wanting to encourage, and we're wanting to see beyond the letter of the law.
Yeah, so tick box kind of approach. I mean, interestingly, there is empirical studies which suggest your own parliament does this with the ECHR, that in the sense you don't think about the deep, profound principles of the European Convention. You ask, has it been signed off by the lawyers? And think, oh, well, tickety-boo. Yeah. So, I mean, it is something which institutions of a range of kinds subject to rights face. It's quite easy to call for the mainstreaming of rights. The experience of mainstreaming rights or also mainstreaming equality considerations is not great thus far. Mm-hmm. So that's simply another challenge which this bill faces, but it's not unusual in that respect.
Okay, I'll leave it there for now. Thanks.
Thank you. I will bring in Megan, but just a quick question. I just wondered whether any of you, what involvement you had in the development of the amendments to the UNCRC, if any at all, has no... No. Okay. Yeah. Just wanted to know. Megan?
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel. There's a lot to unpick already, I think, just from the first couple of questions. And I think, you know, that's taken a different landscape to the previous panel, which is really good because we're getting into the nitty-gritty, I think, of the legislation itself. And I think my questions have strayed a little just because of the discussions that we've had so far. And if I could start with Derek Frew, please, as the Temporary Chief Superintendent. Just on the age of a child, because I think that is really important, actually, when we're looking at legislation that impacts children and young people directly. And we have, you know, this anomaly that's now existing within Scotland where you can do different things at different ages because you're considered a child or not considered a child at certain points in your life. And I'm just wondering, do you think, given that we've got the UNCRC bill, but we've also got the Children Care and Justice bill that's coming through Parliament just now as well, do you think the government needs to be stricter or, you know, define when a person goes from being a child to an adult? Because that's certainly something that I'm wrestling with, and I know it's something that other people are wrestling with as well, just in terms of legislation, because just now it just seems to be a minefield in the justice system. You're, you know, at age at some point, but then, you know, in something else, it's completely different. So I'm just wondering what your thoughts are on that, and please, Dr. Andrew Tickle, please come in as well.
From a policing perspective, I suppose we really like things black and white, let's be honest, because it makes the decision-making far easier. So it would be lovely in a perfect world if we had 18 as the age of definition for a child. However, I'm quite sure the panel from the first panel, children might be quite peeved when they don't get certain rights when the age of an adult when the age hit 16. So certainly not from a policing perspective to make any comment on that legislative framework. In principle, I agree of that simplicity, but I think that complex legal landscape and attaining the rights of an adult versus a child probably make that for lawyers to go into a room and sort that out. It's not one for me to comment, probably.
I'm just wondering if...
Yeah, I think the legal concept of a child is complex because the social concept of a child is complex and push in different directions. So in the sense we can see with the Care and Justice Bill, on the one hand, a sort of protective approach, but then we also have the demands of autonomy, and they are oftentimes in a degree of conflict. And actually, this isn't something which is entirely new to our own time. I was reading one of my colleagues' PhD earlier on last week, and it's all about the fluctuations in the historic concept of childhood, which has changed a lot in a range of different areas. Now, as we, I suppose, have more protection extended to some behaviours, but also greater recognition of child autonomy. But certainly it is a complexity. And if you sit down with your students and ask, well, what can I not do at any given point, then you can sometimes search for coherence in vain. I suppose it's something we can argue about, which is a good thing, in fact, because it's not a settled category. It's not a given. It's something we construct and something the law supports the constructions of around that. So in this area, I don't know if it adds complexity or not, but I think it's fundamentally quite a complex question.
No, thank you very much for that. And if I can move on to the discussions, and I think Dr. Andrew Tickle, you touched on it in your opening remarks, just in terms of young people understanding the rights that they will have once this legislation gets over the line if the amendments are accepted. So I'm just wondering, how do we go about ensuring that young people do understand their rights? And we had an excellent example earlier on in the first panel where it was a demonstration, and I'm just wondering, you know, is that something I think the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament need to get better at to make sure that we are able to reach across a span of ages? Because I think we're really good at talking to ourselves, but we're not necessarily good at talking to the people outside the room.
I'm sorry, I didn't bring any visual aids. I feel as if I kind of let you all down in terms of that. Well, I suppose the children, as a matter of international law, already have these rights. The UK has signed up to these rights. I think the children you were talking to in your class, convener, I'm sure understood very well these fundamental concepts as applied to them. Where it gets complex is not the rights themselves or the broad principles they articulate. It's on enforceability and who it is enforceable against and when. So in that sense, telling the children of Scotland they have these rights is absolutely fine, we can do so now. But on enforceability, I think it's a challenge. And you can see this from both the perspective of sort of rights holders, their advocates, but also for duty bearers and public authorities. And I think both of these parties have an interest in accessibility and simplicity, but those aren't available to you, would be my message in general. So all we can try and do is minimise complexity in a way which makes it possible for those cases which can be articulated and legal advice is available to reach the courts and for that to be an appropriate thing to happen. But I think it's fundamentally extremely challenging, though it will diminish over time. I don't want just to be a herald of woe on this score, that when you pass this legislation, as I expect is quite likely, that is the point of greatest complexity. Why do I say that? Because at this stage, you have the most devolved law still set out in Westminster legislation. But as time goes by, very little time, perhaps, for some panellists who want you to immediately audit every area of Scots law that affects children and legislate for it, whether that's viable or not, over time, more and more law will fall within the parameters of the UNCRC legislation as you pass more Acts of Parliament. So that's why I say it's at its most complex right now. In terms of messaging around that, I don't actually know how you explain a simple version in terms of the wider public. So I don't think that's a failure on you. It's a failure of the situation in which we find ourselves. And I would say that the extent to which the UK Supreme Court judgment, in my view, and it's just my view, is fundamentally impractical in terms of the kind of legislative proposal you are looking at right now and didn't consider a range of the challenges we're trying to talk through right now.
And do you think, just finally, convene a really short question, do you think that there's a risk then that there could be a risk of over-promising and under-delivering for young people? Because I think this is huge for young people, and young people have been calling for it, goodness, since I was at school. So that's how long this has been going on. So, you know, once it's over the line, we need to make sure that we're careful in terms of that, you know, over-promising and under-delivering, because at the end of the day, it is our young people that this will directly impact.
Exactly. And so often you can enshrine. Enshrining is a thing parliaments like doing. Enshrining is easy and cheap and unenforceable. And very often people want the reality. They don't care about the bold, big principle being articulated in legislation. Or if they do care about that, what matters in the end is what can I do about it? And yeah, that is always a risk, not just for this legislation, but also I think for the Human Rights Bill as well. Because if we tell people, I'll see you in court, or we can challenge this in court if you don't uphold my rights, we're not being entirely candid about what this bill will actually achieve.
No, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Paul, please.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. In the previous answer from Dr. Tickle, we started to touch on the audits and I suppose the debate that exists in this space. This morning we had a number of witnesses speak about the approach they would like to see, not least Together and the Children's Commissioner looking at that sort of audit approach they would take. Obviously, COSLA has a different view to some extent. So I wonder if, Dr. Tickle, you might want to comment on the principle of audits and what might might happen in that space and your view of that, and then I'll come to Councillor Buchanan on the causal point.
Yeah, absolutely. So for starters, I think it is absolutely right and proper to identify specific areas where you think the UNCRC is not being observed in Scots law, whether that's about religious observance in school or whether it's about what the Criminal Procedure Act says about the sentencing of children to life imprisonment. That makes sense to me. That's the kind of thing you do all the time in this Parliament. Here's an issue, here's an amendment, let's fix it. I think a legislative audit, if you begin to look at the legislation in question, if it's legislative audit towards the idea that it's a bumper bill, we're going to have a massive education bill, a massive Keeping the Promise bill, then I'm not sure how rooted in reality that is. Because if you dig up the Education Scotland Act, it's over 100 provisions. If you dig up the Social Work Act of 1968, it's over 100 provisions. If you dig up another key area, it's over 100 provisions. And there is, I think, an argument being made from some quarters that all you have to do is just bundle up all the existing law into one or more mega bills and just pass it. And that's not what legislation is for. I mean, that is not an appropriate approach to revisiting the past and the proposals set out in legislation. And you'll notice yourselves that the law sits in the books untouched for years, and it's used by the people who use it, and the rest of us don't think about what it says. But if I came forward as a Scottish Government Minister and said to you, let's reenact an entire piece of legislation and let's not talk about what's in it, you would regard me with profound suspicion and think I was squirreling things in, which we should look again at. Because if we're looking again at legislation, let's use the time to look again at it. So I do find the idea that if it's an audit towards a kind of comprehensive consolidation of all of these areas of law, that's a huge, huge demand on the Parliament's time. Simply for the purposes of making it subject to the UNCRC, I imagine you would struggle. I find the opportunity costs associated with that difficult to defend, to be honest. So I think it's unrealistic for me to that extent. But if there are specific issues, then by all means, those should be addressed.
I wonder, Convener, if I might just have the causal position, because obviously it differs slightly from what we heard this morning.
Yeah. Well, perhaps slightly, not having heard all of this morning's discussion, but yeah, and I think it's, some of it's just been touched on. In relation, for example, children's social work, not all of the key legislative asks are included in UNCRC. Education, again, some would be in scope, some not. For example, Education Act 1980 would not be in scope. But the Education Additional Support for Learning in Scotland Act 2004, as amended, would be in scope. So if you then start to look at it in an audit or legislative audit, we recognise that this would be hugely complicated and indeed, no doubt, time-consuming task, meaning that it cannot be seen as a straightforward solution. Some of the other aspects from a local government perspective would be that councils are already struggling with the capacity to manage the level of legislative change and policy change already underway and on the horizon, and that further demands in this area would represent a huge undertaking in terms of just the additional capacity and the resource required to implement any further extensive cross-sector legislative change. So we have a strong view that the Scottish Government should undertake a scoping exercise to determine public authority functions which will be in and out of scope. And I think this is key in supporting public authorities to understand their obligations, because there is so much potentially adrift, as indeed Andrew has already touched on, that doesn't tie up and that will be a long process and will be time consuming.
Anything further?
I think just to try and get a sense of what might be a way forward, because I know that Dr. Tickell, you had commented at the time of the outcome of the Supreme Court case around the opportunity that might be within that ruling to then look at Scottish Acts in terms of some of the things we're talking about. But I appreciate what you've just said in your previous answer about the complications that surround all of this. So do you have a view in terms of what the most appropriate way forward is?
So I think proceeding with the bill as proposed is sensible. I think in terms of duty bearers, we'll have specific demands on what's in and what's out, and that raises the risk that that Maggie Chapman was describing, but would be practically helpful for them. I mean, over time, all I'm saying about, I suppose, a consolidation or scrutiny of areas of social work or education, if Parliament wants to do that and there are reasons to change the law, then that's an appropriate thing to do. I just think that the idea that Parliament should simply re-legislate for the purposes of UNCRC compliance is not rooted in my perception of the burdens of work which you have in front of you. And in any case, would not be acceptable to parliamentarians if that actually happened, if the government tried to present it in that way. However, over time, the more pieces of legislation you pass on social work, on education, the more you will consolidate the law into kind of single places. And this is something which lawyers like, service users like, and actually public authorities like as well. If you talk to people that work in social work, they say they really struggle with how diffuse the legal sources are which they are dealing with. So if we're accentuating the positive in that way, maybe this Parliament too often has taken the view, we've already got this long-standing big piece of legislation passed before devolution, just add a line here, delete a few words there, sneak in a couple of extra sections and job done. Maybe at this stage, particularly given the aspirations of the Human Rights Bill more generally, the Scottish Government, but yourselves, might think maybe we should have more consolidating acts and really look seriously at specific areas, because it can have all of these collateral benefits as well as extending the UNCRC to them.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm just going to jump back in here for a moment. So the bill provides that it will commence 6 months after royal assent. Is that sufficient time for duty bearers and rights holders to prepare for this amended approach before the bill comes into force? And I suppose I'm going to go to Councillor Tony on that one and then Derek, please.
Again, you know, the bill will be the bill. It's not for us to comment on. Our issue is with the implication, the delivery of it, if you like, and the practical implications that we face. And from that point of view, I think the messaging will be critical within it, as in, you know, our view has certainly been one that there must be clear messaging in terms of once it does progress to that stage, outlining what the UNCRC legislation then is and will have in terms of the public authority functions and what it will mean in practice. So that has to be laid out.
So I do get that, but the criticisms that are obviously legitimate are that, you know, we need this, that and the next thing, but people won't say by when. And I suppose this is an opportunity for us to sort of like hear, you know, what your view on that is. So I'm going to push you on that. I mean, you might not want to narrow it down to 6 months or so, but that's what we've got in front of us. So have a go. Give us a timescale.
Well, it's difficult because at the moment we don't know what's all included. And depending what is actually there and is about to become legislation and become the practice, if you like, then that will determine, in many respects, the timescale that that's going to take to feed in and to enable individuals to understand.
I understand that there is a balance between sort of like doing things quickly and doing them correctly. And, you know, the two are not necessarily the same thing. However, I am mindful that we are trying to take evidence and people's views on the implementation, you know, duty bearers and rights holders and things, and to get an idea of what is the realistic timescale so that we as a committee can take a view on that. But thank you. Derek, do you have anything to add to that?
Certainly, I'm not an experienced legislator, so what I'm just about to say, I don't even know if it's feasible. So, but in terms from a policing context, about like the councillor just said, it's not within our gift to try and make a decision on that date. But in terms of the principle of the enactment 6 months after royal assent, if there's anything in that bill that then allows a bit of reassurance to a duty bearer on the litigation element. In terms of that, we, as I said in, when I answered Maggie Chapman's question, the police certainly, and I think all public bodies, are absolutely committed to delivering the UNC principles. So on the basis that we are already doing that, is there a point where that bill gets enacted where there is a period of time that allows all that clarity to come, allows us to do those child right impact assessments or whatever the relevant process that we decide to adopt, allow us to look at our custody provision without that risk of litigation coming down? So can we enact a bill that then gives us all a huge reassurance from a duty bearer that we have still got time to implement, that we do not need to be at a state of absolute readiness for day one of the Act, because I think that's what gives us the nervousness, and I'm not speaking on behalf of the councillor, but we would probably, in the nicest possible way, would like to delay that 6 months after Royal Assent, because there's a nervousness round about our ability to be adherent from day one. So I don't, but I'm not a legislator, so I don't know if that suggestion's even possible. So I don't know if you know at all.
Thank you. Thanks for that. I'd like to bring in my colleague Karen, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I asked the first panel this morning a specific question on the plans for the Scottish Government to bring forward new human rights law based on 4 international human rights treaties. And I mentioned yourself, Dr. Tickell, and I suppose you flagged a concern that this may have, mirror the difficulties that we've seen here with the UNCRC bill. So it was just to ask yourselves what I'd asked the previous panel. What do you think the Scottish Government, the Parliament, rights bearers, and duty bearers have, what warnings can you give us? Is there advice that you could give us going forward with this legislation that we can see now for it coming down the line?
That's a really interesting question. I think what you're discussing today around what law should human rights apply to is just the questions you would face if it's envisaged the human rights bill will have teeth in terms of enforceability. So for the other human rights that have been mentioned, can I go to court? Can I test the compatibility of legislation? Can I even strike down some legislation in court? At the moment, it's not clear what the Scottish Government's approaches will be to the enforceability of some of the rights that are proposing to be incorporated. And some people have been critical and are demanding that it should be more enforceable and you should be able to bring cases to court. If they're successful in persuading the Scottish Government of that point, then everything we've said about the UNCRC bill will apply to all the other rights which are arguable in court. So what it will mean is that any law emanating from Westminster cannot be touched by it, and it will only apply to Acts of the Scottish Parliament and none of the amendments that you've made from 1998 to the present day. That is the net effect of what it means. And I think it's very telling that talking to colleagues about the practical impact of that, you've had demands just for the UNCRC for audits of work, clear lists of what duties are in or out. Just imagine undertaking the same task for every other right which is proposed to be incorporated in the Human Rights Bill, because that's exactly what will be asked for in terms of the approach that the UK Supreme Court's judgment and the Cabinet Secretary's response to it has set in train. So that's why I flagged that right now, that if you want any rights to be enforceable in court, then everything we're talking about now, it echoes profoundly for all of the other types of rights that are set out in that bill. And I'm not sure, because of its technicality and just the difficulty of explaining these distinctions, I'm not sure that campaigners, third sector groups, the wider public have fully anticipated or appreciated just how dramatic the consequences are for that proposal.
Yeah. And if I can just follow that up. Is there a solution? Is there several solutions? what can we look at in terms of trying to get this workable?
Do you want solutions rooted in political reality or abstract ones that aren't?
I will leave that to yourself to decide.
Well, let's start with it. So, I mean, there are a range of ways this could work. The UNCRC could be easily incorporated into UK law, and if it was echoing the structures of the Human Rights Act, then that would be very straightforward. But we know as a matter of policy that is not the UK government's position and is not likely to be for the foreseeable future. If the UK government had decided the Scotland Act could be amended to make this process easier, then that would be a potential solution. But unsurprisingly, they haven't, because Alistair Jack pursued the reference procedure and rejected the approach to applying to Westminster legislation that the bill at stage 3 articulated. So it's not surprising that that's not really a practical solution, but it would be one way of dealing with it. If Westminster passed amendments to the Scotland Act to say that the Scottish Parliament has legislative competence to introduce human rights provisions which can apply to UK legislation in devolved areas, that is the neatest solution from a legalistic point of view, to my mind, for a range of the issues you face here and would face with the Human Rights Bill. But in my view, neither of those are likely to materialise or to be practically possible. So what you are left with is this. And it's not an insignificant achievement. It is an incorporation of these international rights into Scots law. That is not a negligible achievement and is one which many campaigners and colleagues from children onwards feel deeply committed to. And I don't want to minimise that as a significant impact. But I do think there's a reluctance on the part of human rights campaigners to really own the difficulties around this. It's why no one really wants to talk about it, because it's an agenda which really suits no one politically, I think.
That's really helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Karen. I'd like to bring in Fulton, who is online.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. The question I'm going to ask, we have had a wee bit of discussion about it, both in the previous panel, if you managed to see that, and there's been some discussion in this panel as well. And that's around COSLA and Social Work Scotland both having indicated the legal complexities that will be created following amendments to the UNCRC Bill, with Social Work Scotland describing it as potentially impossible legislative landscape. And I know that that was quoted by my colleague Paul Kane on the previous panel as well. What do you think will be the impact on duty bearers under the UNCRC Bill if passed? And more importantly, I think, because we all want this to work, how can these impacts and difficulties be addressed? Convener, like the last panel session, I'm happy for you to chair in terms of your response.
Thanks, Fulton. I'll go to Derek first, then Andrew, and then Tony.
Thanks. I think the way Police Scotland will take it forward, I suppose, is the child rights impact assessment process, because we need to be able to audit, I think, what we are going to do in terms of that reporting requirement, which I believe is proposed to be 3-yearly. So for us to address those legislative challenges, first bit is understanding that with the audit and the guidance, sector-specific guidance. We then need to interpret that through our own legal representatives within the Police Scotland. We then need to see, well, what parameters that, what impact does that have? As I said, if it is, for example, we're custody environs, if we're expected at any point to create a separate custody suite for children aged between 12 and 18, that's a significant ask. Our current estate certainly wouldn't facilitate that, and we would need to find out, for example, us ensuring that we close our custody suite, I'm just hypothesising, that we close our custody suite for any time a child between 12 and 18 comes in, they don't see any other adults during that other than the police officers that are having to do the necessary processing, and then we make sure that there's a room, which wouldn't be a cell, that can be allocated to them. But it's probably in every reality still going to be in an existing custody suite. Now, does that meet the expectations of government and partners? Does it meet the legislative threshold? So I'm just giving that as an example. We would really need to work through that. Other policies and practices we could do, whether it's a bespoke child rights impact assessment or we incorporate it into our current equality and human rights impact assessment, which has age as a protected characteristic, that we would make sure there was sufficient guidance to staff that covered the UNCRC requirements. So we're still at the decision whether we have a bespoke one or we build it into our current process. But again, what does that tell us? And actually applying that to a process in practice might actually shine some legal complexities that maybe we just didn't pick up before. So that's why I was, that being compliant at day one of enactment gives me a sense of nervousness that Police Scotland as a public body can actually be at a point of compliance on day one. And that's why I think it's so difficult to give a day of go live from you're looking for our opinion. That's why I think it's so hard for us to do that, and same for COSLA, because they'll be even more complex than the policing landscape is, if that's answered the question.
Andrew?
Yeah, I think one of the interesting things here is, even if we hadn't had the complexity that the Supreme Court judgment has introduced into this whole discussion, I actually think we might still be having quite a similar debate from public authorities about what do these rights mean. In the sense, if you read the language of the UNCRC or the European Convention on Human Rights, it's big, bold and unspecified principles. They're not rules, they're principles. And actually, across the public sector and beyond, what they mean in practice is something that we very often have a dawning realisation of. It's not a set of strict rules which can straightforwardly be applied. And therefore, that, I think, perhaps adds to the sense of complexity, that public authorities perhaps are looking at this, thinking it was already difficult for us to know precisely what a right to privacy or a right to autonomy or whatever it might be means for us in our practical day-to-day work. And now we're told that half of the stuff we do is subject to these rights and the other half isn't. So I wonder if perhaps that combination is partly what's driving some of the anxieties. It is probably worth saying, though, that the rights are articulated as broad principles. You can't simply create a long list of rules out of them, because if you do that, you lose the substance of what the right is about. And that, I think, again, maybe goes back to what Maggie Chapman was saying, that there's pressures in two different directions, in the sense what you're being asked for is a long list of simple rules which we can follow and we'll be all right, which is understandable from a defensive kind of point of view, but is not fundamentally what the UNCRC actually says. So I think we're seeing that combination of complexity on two different fronts here, again, both of which are unavoidable.
Thank you. Tony?
Yep. I think just to go back, it comes back to, I think, the first points I'd made in my opening speech. It was just, we need to undertake an exercise to identify what and which public authority functions will be in and out of scope. I think that has to be a priority. And then we have to provide the detailed, as Derek touched on, the sector-specific guidance for public authorities, because without that, we will all be looking at it on day one and saying, what can we do? What can't we do? What are we allowed to do? What are we not allowed to do? Because unless we have that, we envisage that there could be significant problems arising.
OK, thank you. Fulton, do you have any supplementary questions? You're satisfied with those answers? A thumbs up there. just in closing, this is the main evidence session. We've had the panel this morning as well, and we're also going to be hearing from the Cabinet Secretary. So do you think that is sufficient scrutiny on the amendments? And if not, then what advice would you give us? What thoughts would you share with us? And do you have any views on any further witnesses that we could hear from as well? That would be really helpful to us on the committee. So, Derek?
No, I think what you've laid out is sounds great from my perspective, from a policing perspective. My experience, and it's probably from a community planning partnership, from a working at local authority level, and I know we've heard the voice of children today, but we signed a pledge where I previously worked for, as a youth pledge, nothing about us without us. And I don't know if we're hearing from a youth voice, and I don't know if that could come from the member of the Scottish Youth Parliament or some. There's youth cabinets all through Scotland from local authorities, so I just thought it may be a valuable suggestion.
Thank you. Thanks for that suggestion. Andrew?
I think if you look at the compass of the amendments, they're quite limited, in fact. I think they run to about 5 pages, I think, is what the Cabinet Secretary has proposed. Going back to your earlier point about the six-month commencement, that fundamentally reflects impatience, I suspect, from the sector that finally this legislation, which seems to have been around forever, needs to get on the statute book and come into force rapidly. I think the issues are fairly tightly limited from a legal point of view, in terms of the choices that you've been presented by the Cabinet Secretary, and hopefully their implications are perhaps a little clearer to you all, having taken more evidence on it. So in that sense, because there is relatively little room to manoeuvre on how the Scottish Government can comply with the Supreme Court judgment, unless people have thought of something that I haven't, and it's every possibility that's true, then I don't think there are solutions to the problems that have been presented in a legislative sense. There may be practical solutions, things the Scottish Government can do, but there aren't any other legislative solutions, in my view, to these problems. So what you would gain through engaging in further scrutiny of that, I'm not so sure.
Thanks for that. Tony?
Yeah, no, I would tend to agree. I think everyone has submitted their statements. You've heard the evidence, and we've highlighted the potential pitfalls, if you like, of it, but we are working within a very limited framework, which ultimately results in a limited amount more that can be done, because it is going to be extremely tight. It is very limiting from the point of view that the scope has to be held back from what we would probably all want to see, given that we all want to see children's rights upheld and enabled, and there are clearly some barriers to that.
Thank you. Thank you. And on that note, I would like to thank all the witnesses from appearing in this particular panel. And this concludes the formal part of our business this morning. And I wish you well for the rest of your day. Thank you.